بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه المنتجبين ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الذين إن مكناهم في الأرض أقاموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة وأمروا بالمعروف ونهوا عن المنكر ولله عاقبة الأمور. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد.
Tonight I'd like to speak about our responsibilities towards our countries and our societies, towards the land that we live in, the country that embraces us, the home that cater for us. In Islam, the concept of the love of the country and the love of the land and the home is embedded in the Holy Quran and the tradition of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we all read that حُبُّ الْوَطَنِ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. To be loyal, to be respectful, to care for your country, to care for your home. This is part of faith, part of being a good believer, a good worshipper. A good worshipper is the one who cares not only about his family, but his land and his country and his society. And where is your land? I think for us, the Muslims who are living here in America, now this is our home. Many of us have been born in Iran, Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, Egypt, Palestine, North Africa. Many of us are immigrants who came to this country many years ago. Some of you are second generation, third generation. But since you live and you consider this part of the world as your home, then this is your watan, this is your country. And Imam Ali alayhi salam has something beautiful. He says, khayrul bilad, what is the best home for you? Which one is the best home? He answers this. He says, khayrul bilad ma hamalak, la ma hamalak. The best land, the best home, your real country is the land that embraces you and caters for you, and it protects you, and respects you. حَمَلَك, bears you. لَا مَا حَمَّلَك, not the land that tortures you, or burdens you. Don't call the land that tortures you a home, but the land that embraces you, receives you, provides you with peace, with security, with food, with the clothing, with education, with healthcare, with equality, with dignity, with respect. This is your home. This is your home. In Islam, we consider the land, not only the land where we were born in. Any land that you can live peacefully in it, we consider it home. We consider it home. And therefore, the home, we have obligations and responsibilities towards our home. In the same way that we receive from this home, we receive benefits. Our children, they receive benefits. They grow here, they learn here, they go to school here, they get a job here, we make an income, decent income here. Therefore, you have responsibilities. What are the responsibilities? I put them in a few points. The most important responsibility we have towards the home, and in this case here, in America. Your home is America now. Yes, it's okay to have two homes. You say, my home is in the Middle East, and I have a second home. But since you live here, and most of you are the citizens of this land, this is your home. In this case, the first responsibility is not to exploit this country, this society. not to mishandle, not to abuse or misuse this country. We have to respect this country. We have to have a sense of belonging. Number one duty we have is to take care of the natural resources that God has given us. Some of them are in the earth, down. Some of them are above the earth. We have to take care of them. Some of it is an oil reserve. Some of it is fishery. Some of it is livestock. Some of it is crops. Some of it are beaches, deserts, the soil, the air. We have to take care of it. National parks, we have to preserve them. God says, these are my trust. أنشأكم منها واستعمركم فيها. هو الذي أنشأكم من الأرض واستعمركم فيها. He created you in this land. He wants you to build it. So take care of it. These are national treasures. And we, the Muslims, should be the pioneers in preserving them. Preserving the soil, preserving the sea, the beaches, the deserts, the air. We have to take care of the environment. Remember I spoke about a Muslim, good Muslim being. At the same time, when you are a good Muslim, you have to be an environmentalist. To take care of the environment. The environment. Anything around you. The environment, it could be human beings in your neighborhood, in your community. It could be objects. Physical objects. You have to take care of it. The greenery. You have to make your city beautiful. This is not only the job of the city or the mayor, the job of every citizen, to keep his neighborhood clean. Unfortunately, let me share this with you. I traveled extensively in America. I have seen over 40 states. And I go and I visit Muslim neighborhoods. Unfortunately, the majority of them, they don't live in good neighborhoods. Or at least they don't take care of their neighborhoods, the vast majority of them. Whereas, I believe, if we want to say we are Muslims, we are proud of our Islam, and our Islam is a good religion, the first thing we should do, before thinking of prayers or fasting, is to take care of your neighborhood. The safety, the security, the cleanliness, the prosperity, of your neighborhood, of your street. Make your house the best house. Take care of it. Al-Nadhafatul Iman. Al-Nadhafatul Iman. Cleanliness, neatness, being organized. Is faith, is an act of faith, an act of religion, an act of belief. So we have to take care of our neighborhoods. If there is something wrong in the neighborhood, in your street, you have to be the first one. You have to be the first one to take the initiative to go and fix it, to go and clean it. Take care of the land you live in. Make it a beautiful land. Make it peaceful. Do you know that one day, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he noticed that some of the companions around him, they don't shower, they don't clean themselves, they don't clean their dress. He was somehow angry. He said to them, listen, do you know that when you don't clean yourself, when you don't cut your hair, when you don't clip your nails, when you don't wear perfume, attar, angels are not going to get close to you. You are going to fend them off. Keep them away from you. So don't do that. And even in the mosque, when you don't clean yourself and you go to the mosque, the Holy Quran says, خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. When you go to the mosque, you have to wear your zina, your ornaments, the best dress, the best perfume. خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. And the zina here has two meanings. One of them is this. This is zina, what you wear. The second is the akhlaq, the manners. also is something attractive. So when you go to the masjid, be in a good mood, be smiling, be forgiving, be accommodating in the mosque. This is zina. This is part of the attraction and the ornaments. So he said to his companions, if you don't clean yourself and you don't clean your homes, then the angels are not going to get close to you. You are keeping them away from you. So try to take care of these points. This is number one. Number one point, we live in a country, we have to make that country beautiful. You live in a city, you live in a neighborhood, your neighborhood has to look organized and beautiful. And you have to take care of everything. Do not pollute. We, the Muslims, we should not pollute. There is a sign that I always like when I see it on the freeway. It says, there is a $1,000 penalty for littering. I wish we can have these signs in Arab countries and Muslim countries. I wish. We don't have it, unfortunately. This is how you keep your country beautiful. This is how you keep your country beautiful. The sign of faith is a cleanliness. If they take you somewhere, it's not a clean, it means faith is missing. Even if people pray 10 times a day. So we have to be the leaders, the pioneers. We have to be the leaders in this regard. To teach our children, to teach the young generation that take care of this country. Sometimes the pollution is in the air. We have to ask our family members, if the drive, this ride is not necessary, don't do it. Because you are contributing into the air pollution when you use your vehicle, if you don't need it. Sometimes we have to use the family members, you have to carpool. Rather than driving three vehicles going to the same destination, we carpool to save the environment, to protect the environment. Sometimes the pollution is in the water. Sometimes the pollution is noise pollution. Have you been to some capitals? I don't want to mention the names of these capitals. You can't sleep during the night. Even if you live in the best hotel, if you go to the best hotel and you close the windows, still you cannot sleep because of the noise pollution. This is not good. It's not good for your health. Neither good for the physical health nor the mental health. Allah says, no noise pollution. Try to keep it down. Try to respect the environment. Respect others. Respect your neighbors. If you have neighbors close to you, those neighbors have to be very satisfied with you. A neighbor in your neighborhood should say, those are real Muslims, because they are so clean, they are so disciplined, they don't make any sort of pollution, no noises. This is Islam. This is Islam and nothing else. That's the byproduct of the genuine faith, is to be good in your community. An element of goodness, an element of khayr. الَّذِينَ إِن مَكَّنَّاهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَوُ الزَّكَاةَ and then وَأَمَرُوا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. They enjoin everything that is good. وَنَهَوْا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ and they forbid everything which is bad or evil. That's the real Islam. So this is number one. The second duty that we have towards our countries is civic engagement, political activism. Every single Muslim, male or female, have to be an activist in their societies. Political activist. I'll give you an example of how to be a political activist. You have to participate in the political life. Unfortunately, Muslims in America, their number is not small. Some people put the number at 7 million, 8 million, probably 10 million, I don't know. We don't have an exact census. But when it comes to the political arena, The political life, they are missing. Therefore, the candidates, be it local or federal, state or federal, be it the president or others, they don't care about the Muslims. Why? Because they know that they don't go to the ballot box. Although they are citizens, and some of them they've been in this country for 50 years, they don't care about the political process, and this is not good. In America, if you want to be respected, if you want the politician to respect you and listen to you, you have to go to the ballot box. You have to cast your vote. They should know that you are a voting power. Your vote counts. And I spoke to many congressmen. They tell me sometimes we win by a very small margin, probably only 20 votes. 20 votes, not 200, determine our future. Because the contest is so close between the contenders, and one of them wins by only 20 votes. It sends him to the Congress. So you have to ask your family members, your friends, that this is my fate. I'm a taxpayer in America. I'm a citizen. I have to decide my fate. Islam says you have to decide your fate wherever you live. You have to have a voice. You have to have a say. You have to change. We always ask the Americans, please do this for us. Help us. Don't do that. Don't. But when it comes to us, we don't do anything. They ask us, where is your vote? You know, when you go and meet someone, he says, how many people listen to you? How many of your people in your community, they cast their votes? How many? What do you tell them? Do you lie? Do you tell them all my people go? No, I'm not going to tell them that. You are respected if you have a voice. If you vote, you will be a good citizen. They consider you, they respect you, they listen to you. But if not, nobody is going to listen. Nobody is going to listen. So political participation. And then when we go and vote, we have to vote for the best, lil aslah. Not only the best for the Muslims, the best for the American people. Some people say, I'm going to vote for someone who only respect the Muslims. No, I'm not going to do that. Myself, I'm going to vote for someone who respects the American people. We are part of the humanity. We are part of the humanity. We should not judge the candidates by only one dimension or two, one aspect. If he's pro-Palestine, pro-Arabs, then I'm going to vote for him. If not, I'm not. No, it's not only that. You have to look at that person. Is he serving America? The interest of America? The interest of the people of America? There are 320 million Americans. So we should not be narrow-minded and only we focus on our own narrow interests and we forget about others. We should go for the one who respects the will of the majority of the Americans. Someone who advocates health care. You know how many Americans, they don't have health insurance here in this country? We have the best hospitals, the best clinics, the best surgeons, the best doctors. But still, some people can't afford going to see a doctor. We have to advocate this. We have to advocate good education. We have to advocate fighting crime. We have to advocate justice for all, in particular for the black people in this country. Reforms in the police force. These are national issues that we must participate in them. You are part of this country. Your children are going to grow here, and even if you want to take them back home, they say, no, sorry, you go home, I stay here. This is my home. This is my land. This is my future. This is a fact. This is a fact. So you have to build your future. Today I read a disturbing survey in the CNN that Muslims in France, they make 10% of the population. 10% is a huge number. You know, the French are always almost 60 million people. 10% of them, it means 6 million people are Muslims. They make 10% of the population, but they also make 70% of the population in the prisons. 70% of those who are behind bars in the prisons, 70% of them are Muslims. Wow. Why? Is this Islam? And most of them, 99% of those who are behind bars, they are there for criminal records. Theft, burglary, whatever. Why? Is this Islam? How do you convince the French people that my religion is a peaceful religion? When 70% of the people in the prisons are Muslims. How do you convince them? That does not work. We have to change ourselves. Islam is a religion of real peace, not just prayers. Some people believe in the 5 daily prayers, but when it comes to being peaceful with others, they don't understand that. Most Muslims are angry, unfortunately. I've been to France, I've been to Germany, I've been to certain mosques, and I see how people fight after the prayers, immediately. As soon as they say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, the fight begins. They disrespect others. They have no tolerance for other madahib, for other schools of thought. This is not Islam. Islam is a religion of inclusion. Islam is a religion that says you have to respect people for being humans, regardless of their color, regardless of their ideology. We don't ask people, tell me, what is your madhab, what is your religion, what is your school of thought, what is your nationality, so I decide whether I respect you or I not. We don't. Inna akramakum inda Allah. The most people who have self-control and piety and consciousness. Walaqad karramna bani Adam. Allah says in chapter 17, Bani Adam are honored. Don't ask about their identity. Don't. The story of Ibrahim when he built the house. When he built the house, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ. And then the man came to get some food, and Ibrahim questioned him about his religion. The man was angry. He left. Allah said to Ibrahim, Ibrahim, this man, I'm giving him food for 50 years. I never asked him about his religion. And you are interrogating him today because you are giving him a small meal? Give him. Don't ask people about their religion. Allah wants us to serve the humanity. Humanity. And in the humanity, there are some people who they consider themselves to be believers. Some of them are non-believers. They all go and stand before God on the day of judgment. We are not the judge. We should not judge people. We should embrace. This is exactly the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So another political activism that we must get engaged in is discussion with your representatives. Let me ask you, how many of you know your representative here in Irvine, in Costa Mesa, in Orange County? How many of you know the name of your representative in the Congress? Be honest with me, tell me. Raise your hand. Only one. Alhamdulillah. بس عمار هذا بالغلط قال مو صحيح. By the way, Loretta Sanchez is going to come here on Thursday after tomorrow because she's running for the Senate now. She's a congresswoman now. And she's running for the Senate. And we said, okay, come here and we listen to her. She's a House representative, but she's running for the Senate. Instead of, what's her name? Barbara Boxer, I think.
Boxer, yeah.
So you have to know your representative. You have to have a relationship with them. You have to invite them, speak to them. How do you want them to support Islam? Do you know, I read a survey today again, it was in the paper, that Islamophobia is on the rise in America. It's not declining. It's not going down. It's going up. And it is your responsibility and my responsibility to combat this. It's our responsibility. We don't ask a foreign country to come and help us. We are American citizens. We have to do something about it. God will ask me on the Day of Judgment, what did you do? You lived in America for 30 years. You had a good income, good house, good car, children, you raised family. What did you do for Islam in the West, Islam in America? It's our responsibility. If Islamophobia is on the rise, then I am guilty. I'm not doing well. We have to combat that. I know it's because of ISIS. I know because of what is happening in the Middle East. But we have a duty here of fixing this situation. We have to fix it. And we fix it through getting to know others. You know why most Americans, they don't accept Islam? They are suspicious about Islam. When they are asked, why you are suspicious about Islam? Do you know any Muslims? They say, no, we don't know Muslims. They only read about Islam. They watch TV. But they don't know a Muslim. If they get to know you and you invite them and you have a good relationship with them, they say, no, I don't believe this is right, because I know I have a Muslim friend, a Muslim neighbor who's doing well, who loves America, who's serving America, he's serving his family, he's serving his country. This is the way you dispel these stereotypes, by forging good relationship, good friendship with your neighbors. The other thing that we can do, we can influence politics in this country, is through interested groups. Interested groups, I give you an example. We have some Muslim interested groups. One of them is CLEAR, one of them is MPAC, we have others. These interested groups, they introduce an initiative onto the ballot, and they ask the government to introduce this so people vote on it. Propositions, you've heard about them. In regards to healthcare, in regards to education, to social issues, even what happened 2 days ago in the Supreme Court in Washington, the Supreme Court, when they legalized same-sex marriage, it did not come from the president, or it came from pressure groups, interested groups. They introduced this bill, they put the pressure, they lobbied, they went after it day and night, they garnered support, and then they won. In America, if you have a cause, even if that cause is bad, is bad. But if you have supporters, if you garner some support, you can win. It's not about the truth or falsehood here. It's about who has strength, who's working harder in this country. For the very first time in the history of America, a black man was able to be the president. This thing does not happen in France, even in a half a billion years from now. Neither in Britain nor in Germany. But it happens in America, a land of opportunity. Because he took it serious. He said, I want to be the president. And he took it serious, he went after it, he worked hard, he was able to accomplish that. It's a lesson for us. We have to learn. If the Muslims, they sit and they complain, only complain and they do nothing, they're going to complain for the rest of their life and nothing will change. But if the Muslims, as God says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ They have to go after it. We have to encourage our children to be advocates, to be activists. We only encourage them to go to medical school, to law school, to be lawyers, to be physicians. How many of you encourage your children to be a reporter, a journalist, a filmmaker, a politician? Run for the city, run for the council. The other day, the city council of Costa Mesa invited me to give their benediction in the beginning of their session when the mayor comes and the city councilors, they come. They read something. So they invited a Muslim to read something from the Quran. So I went there. They respected me. All of them white Americans. Some of them are Christians, some of them are Jews. For the very first time, a Muslim Imam with his turban, he comes and they have to respect you. And I was reading from the Quran and how I started with this ayah. إن أكرمكم عند الله يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا. To get to know each other, to respect each other, to learn from each other, not to despise each other, not to fight against each other. It made a lot of sense. So they came to me, they said, ask your people to come and participate in these sessions. You have to go and listen, you are a citizen here. They are deciding things on your behalf and you are absent and this is not good. You have to go there. You have to have a voice. Unless we take this initiative, we are not going to succeed. Again, this is our land. This is our country. We have duties and we have responsibilities to empower our families, to empower Islam. But through these channels, not through yelling and shouting and being angry. Not through asking for Sharia. We want Sharia, we want Quran. And then they come to my house is disorganized. I know nothing about my kids. This is not good, this is not going to work. We struggle, but through the legal, reasonable challenge, once we do that, we're going to succeed. I assure you in 20, 30 years, if the Muslims work hard, they're going to be dignified. Then Islamophobia is going to go down. Then no one is going to dare to threaten any Muslim or look down at any Muslim in this country. The same thing that the Jews did. The Jews, when they came here, they were despised, disrespected. Some of the shops, they did not allow no blacks, no Jews, here in America. But they worked hard. And look at what they achieved now. We can do the same, we can learn from the same experience. Allahumma akhfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat tabi' lahum baynana wa baynahum bil khayrat. Allahumma wahhid kalimata al muslimin ala al khayri wal birri was salahi wat taqwa ya arhamar rahimin. اللهم أخمد الفتنة في بلاد المسلمين في اليمن في سوريا في العراق وانصرهم على أعداء الإنسانية وأعداء الدين يا أرحم الراحمين وأن على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية وعجل في فرج سيدنا ومولانا صاحب العصر والزمان وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.